May I please ask us to settle down? We are about to start. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'd like everybody to pick a spot and sit so that we can start properly. But before we start, I'd like to announce again, if you're here and you're not wearing your mask, please do so now. It's very important for this event. We had said in the invitation card that we were going to observe all the COVID protocols, which is why we're having this kind of setting so that we do not have a crowd that we cannot control. And I'm sure that we all do understand that. Thank you very, very much for obliging us. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, my name is Dafe Iwurie. I work for Providence Bank, and it is my honor to invite all of you, to welcome all of you to this event. It is Voices in the Course of Earth, World Poetry Day, which is today. I'm not going to talk too much because time is actually far spent. It's 4:30 p.m. almost. It means that we are beyond time. We want to finish as quickly as we can. Tonight is about poems. It's about the poet. Some of them are already here, seated to my left and to my right. However, when you gather like this for poetry, three things are present. I will introduce the first thing, which is music. The second And the third I will talk about when I come back on stage. And so we must listen to music to set the tone. Set the tone for this evening. And I'd like to introduce my friend from very long time ago. I call her The Voice. She's going to do a Yoruba ballad titled Kolu Akosho. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for the delectable Yinka Davis.
Oh,
Ladies and gentlemen, I am sure we can do the applause louder than that. The great Olayemeka Davis. That was an apt prayer, and I'm sure we all said amen silently. The World Poetry Day, the one we celebrate in Providence Bank, is an event to celebrate cross-generational poetry in Nigeria. And so we bring together those who are in full bloom. And I would recognize the legend and sage, Professor Wole Soyinka, the first Black man to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. I would also recognize Odia Ofemo, who turned 70 yesterday. I'm sorry, last year I meant to say. Those are the ones in full bloom. They are the mid-career poets also, as German will refer to them. They will be on stage tonight also. And of course, you have the budding poets. So that's what you're going to see this evening. But before we go into that, I'd like to introduce to the podium the guy who has made all of this possible from the first time we mooted the idea to do this cross-generational poetry reading. And he didn't hesitate to say no. The man who is the owner of the vision of what is Providence Bank today, and it's becoming a force in the banking industry in Nigeria. I'd like to introduce my managing director, Mr. Walter Akpani, to make his opening remarks. Thank you very much.
Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I hope you can hear me properly. I have to keep this on just to try and ensure that we observe everything regarding the protocols. Permit me to begin my remarks by quoting the respected Wangari Maathai, winner of the 2004 Nobel Peace Prize, when she said, "The issue of climate change does bring home the fact that we are on one planet and that some of the impact of what human beings do in one corner of the world is going to affect people in the distant corner of the world. So we may still feel very far from each other, but we really are very close to one another. Issues of environment and climate change should always be on the front burner. They should always be a talking point and part of conversation that we have in our everyday lives on preserving the health, which we believe was given to us and which we will also leave for generations that will occupy it after we have departed. This World Poetry Day celebration by Providence Bank focuses on climate change. And I believe the impact of Prof's input on this can never be put aside. And the environment which we are talking about is that of ours. So this special theme of voices in the course of the arts is one that we should hold dearly. Just in case we are still at loss about what the issues are, I will also take a quote from Sir David Attenborough when he said, "The truth is that the natural world is changing, and we are all totally dependent on that world. It provides our food, water, and air. It is the most precious thing we have, and we need to protect it and to continuously depend on it." Indeed, Sir Attenborough was a voice in the course of the art for those who know him. His voice will continuously be amplified by those of us who today have chosen to be part of it. We have gathered other voices today to amplify the need to protect the art, and these voices come from Nigeria. The World Poetry Day for the year 2020 was canceled at the 11th hour. I suppose that much of the world was put on hold last year, in a year that can be aptly described as annus horribilis. Following the pandemic, a new normal has been instituted upon the world, which has necessitated us staging the event here in the co-hotel today, instead of our little corner of the world in the cozy ambience of our banking hall. I must, however, on behalf of Providence Bank, thank Professor Wole Soyinka for putting together these voices and literary minds. As we come to find out, some are young, impressionable, and budding. They will be supported by other stronger voices and literary personages. This includes our special guest poet, Odell Fernum, who turned 70 last year. Congratulations once again, sir. I'm also aware that Prof will be joined in the grand finale. And for those who are not aware of this, I think the last time Prof did with must have been some decades back. So it's a great opportunity that we are witnessing Prof performing here today. He will be joined by Taiwo Ajayi Lancet, who also turned 80 last month. They all will be joined both by other dying wool actor Bimbo Manuel. Before I vacate the podium, I take my seat to enjoy today's feast of words. I thought also to mention that Providence Bank has partnered with the NCIC, meaning Nigerian Climate Innovation Center, towards a mutual collaboration to drive and develop the growth of Nigerian green economy by providing debt financing to support eligible climate-friendly green businesses across the country. An initial sum of ₦500 million has been earmarked by Providence Bank to achieve this primary objective of this partnership. In addition, we have also set up an in-house green desk in conjunction with the NCIC to drive issues relating to conservation, environment, sustainability, and other things in the bank. We do hope our little efforts will go more than a mile towards our contribution. Lastly, I wish to thank you all for honoring our invitation under the current circumstances to this year's event. And I invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the ensuing feast of poetic favor. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much, sir. Before you sit back, relax, and enjoy the poetry, we thought it was important for the grand host to say something before we commence. I will do recognitions after that, and then I would hand over to my former boss in The Guardian, Mr. Jaman Anikulaku, to take charge of the other aspects of the event that has to do with poetry. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Wole Soyinka to make some remarks. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. And thanks for braving Lagos traffic even on a Sunday to get here. I know what we went through near Bonny Camp. So congratulations for being here. This event, as you know, should have taken place last year, and then Mr. COVID came along with all his protocols. And in a sense, it's actually not too much of a disaster. It isn't a disaster at all. They're saying in every cloud, there's a silver lining. That's really what I want to say. That by this time, after the invasion of COVID, I think we are all now attuned to that instinct for ensuring that both life and creativity continue no matter what. In addition, since COVID, we've also had the four-legged COVID lost their conveyor belts, two-legged conveyor belts. We know that this nation has never in peacetime experienced such a belligerent state, almost like buffeting from both natural and unnatural causes. In the midst of all this, most of us who are here agree with me that the arts become even more crucial. Sometimes one feels a little bit guilty. But look, what am I doing here? What am I doing with poetry when I know that humanity is bleeding elsewhere? However, it's for that very reason we must assert the will to life, the will to quality life, and the will to creative life. So in a way, it's a therapy. Not consciously thought of it as being one, but actually it is a therapy. It's a statement of defiance. It's a statement on behalf of vitality, of our humanity, a statement against the predators of our community. So let music, poetry, sculpture, painting, craftwork, let them make their own statement steadily and continuously We're just part of the same stream of defiance. So I thank you once again for being here. Those of you who had prepared for last year and missed it, and regretted it, please take this as a kind of special post-COVID event. Because believe it or not, whether Trump believes it or not, COVID is on its way out. With the aid of our scientists and our poets, our artists, our creative beings, we are going to continue to celebrate and enhance the quality of existence. Tonight, let us versify. Thank you very much.
That was a very tactical move down there. I'm sure I probably would have missed a step there and trust the prof not to do that. I will do some quick recognitions here before we go ahead. Tonight we are honored to have the Consulate General of the United States of America in our midst, in the person of Claire Pierangelo. Please a round of applause for her. I'd also like to recognize the presence of the Erelu of Lagos, Erelu Abiola Dosunmu. Also present here tonight, the man who, was it trek or drove through Sahara Desert? Which one was it, sir? Drove through Sahara Desert, Chief Newton Jibuno. And just as I came on stage to make this announcement, the wife of the managing director of Providus Bank, who herself is a businesswoman of note, leading one of the best oil companies in Nigeria by the name Northwest Petroleum and Gas Company Limited. She's here, and she goes by the name Dane Winnie Akpani. Please, a round of applause for her. I think that my job is done here now. It's time for poetry, and I do not know anybody in the industry in Nigeria who knows more about poetry than the man who I'm about to introduce, my former boss in the Sunday Guardian from maybe 15, 20 years ago, still looking young, almost at 60. Ladies and gentlemen, German Anikulapo will steer the ship from now on. Thank you.
I saw brown, I saw black, but then the green picked me. So I'm wearing my green dress. Prof, I'd like to report I just sold this dress for Christmas. But I'm wearing it at this time. So I thought I deserved it. Obviously, those lines are from a poemist. I'm not a poet. And MD, I think you are also a poemist because you don't write poems. Okay. If you don't write poems, but you love poetry, you are a poemist. Please clap for yourself for being a poemist. We are the supporters of poets. The job this evening is very easy. Dafe talked about cross-generational poets, but I've titled it The Young, The Very Young, and The Very, Very Young. And as, when I mention young, think of children. When I say very young, think of parents. And when I say very, very young, think of those who are very young as Professor Wole Soyinka and Taiwo Ajayi Laiset. They are very, very young. You know, they say when you grow old, you become young. So I'll start with the young ones. And let me just give you a quick explanation why how we pick them. In Lagos, Lagos has become a center for poetry. And we think we need to say thank you to Odia Ofemun for what you did to all of us, winning us, you and Ari Garba. After Prof set, you started grooming many of us. And Lagos has become a center for poetry, especially for performance poetry. So we have quite a lot of them who are in Lagos, who we call them the poetry commune, if you check your brochure. We have people who bring them together and then they give them opportunity to express themselves. They form them into clusters and they are all over Lagos. But we decided to pick only from four. But let me just quickly acknowledge the role played by those people. Dagatola, just stand up for recognition for what you did in Ajegunle. Dagatola is at the back there. He started by gathering young poets from Ajegunle. You know, now we talk about Generation Sorosoke, Speak Up. It did not start with NSAS. Our young ones have been speaking up, but we've not been listening to them. We've been speaking up through poetry, through drama, through music. Of course, you know the rest of them. So he started putting them together in Ajegunle. They're called the AJ as of poetry. Thank you very much, Adia in Ajegunle. We have Loud Thoughts, which is mastered by Chisholm. Chisholm, just stand up for recognition. Thank you very much for what you're doing across the country. We have Poet in Nigeria by Eriata Oribabo. But they are also doing their own program today, so it's not able to be here. They have their own poetry today. And the Bariga Poet Collective, Shegun Adefila, please stand up for recognition. You thought my poetry was bad. I tried to join the Bariga Poet, but you said I was not qualified. So I continue to write my watery poems. Now we start with the poet in Nigeria, represented by Phoebe Benjamin.
Good evening. The title of my poem is Environmental Awareness. We are seasonal weathers and oceans, altered by the power of recurring heats, increasing in frequency and ferocity, and smog formations bowing to atmospheric conditions. We are conditions of atmospheric hotness, suffering like greener trees who may blossom but face doom of terrible fruitlessness, like the scriptural fig tree. We are toxic here, breathe at risk to our health, like our waters flowing from polluted springs, sources of pain, cry, tears, and uncleanliness. We are vulnerable children, compromised by sickly waters and deadly sanitations, surrounded by environmental disharmony, all marks of hostile habitats. We are droughts of crop failures. We are waves of food price increases. We are paupers, deprived of nutritional value. We die daily of food insecurity. We are environments surrounded by abuses.
Thank Thank you very much. Benjamin from Poets in Nigeria. And now from AJ House of Poetry, Prince David.
The title of my poem is Smokes and Death. What happens when a farmer plants yam and harvests blood and sweat? The storyline of death is buried in the crackles of countrymen and women who have learned to boil the earth on smokes and coals. Life becomes a burnt grass. To survive, we lost the language of our nose and buried our tongues on daggers. The farmer lost his hopes and origin, only to plant a city under the civilization of vampires, drinking from the tears that tear the heart of existence. And on the table of broken policies, the earth lost its breast. Yet to forget the earth, the breast must be tended if milk must flow. The same milk we drank into the memory of our communal past, before murder was murdered by greed and class. When fellow brother fleshed milk out of sulfur bones of fellow brother's sweat, robots and industries, the farmstead exists no more. The evolution of survival is notched and crowned on the doors of capitalist science. We broke into the heaven and plucked a god to water our burnt graveyard. But Olonko is too angry to drink black oil and Sariwa's blood. The river house becomes a flooded relic of masked guns, black blood, and the end. The land is of red smokes and death, and the country gods still sing in the patriotic feasting of belly and pockets. The placards must rise if earth must survive. Tell what happens to a farmer if the earth lost its wombs and begins to drink blood from the mouth of rapists and money lords. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prince David from AJ House of Poetry. And from Loud Thoughts, Nathaniel Increase.
I know what will kill us first. No, it is not the insurgency nor the race wars. It is what we have done to Mother Earth and all our children. It is how we have rid her of almost all the characteristics of life and left her to thrive on saline naughtiness. The speaking trees have lost their voices. No one sings for the turtles in the Gulf anymore. The seas are silent. The waters have lost their tongues but grown teeth to eat the land. And now Katrina's children are lost in Castina. They warned us, the poets. But we ignored the potents, and now ice will no longer suffice a coolant for the pets of summer. Ice will no longer heal these pores. These blemishes are proof. But these poems have been interrupted by grace. Let us not act like we have not seen these metaphors bleeding paraffins. Let us not act like we do not know that the missing vials were poisoned with lead. It is the evening of creation. The toads have lost their tails. The turtles have lost their voices. The rivers are dying of thirst. And the mackerel must learn to live on helium. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Increase. Nathaniel Increase from Loud Talks. Thank you. And now from Bariga Poets Collective, Chibuzo Naivets.
I would like to tell a story. The title of my story is Dying. Story. Once upon a time, about 4.5 billion years ago, she was born. And that was how the beginning was done. Some say she came with the Big Bang. Others say there was an unseen one, the omnipotent. But the fact remains that she was born long before now. As a toddler, she knew what life was, and that was how she became a boss. So tender, she nurtured all she's got power over. And that was how she became a mother. Still in a constant state of bet and rebet and bet, again and again, it appears that our children, we wish are dead. Sadly, the earth is dying from the wealth we extort from it. We can't keep killing ourselves, destroying the world in every possible way. Day after day, we extort the earth we are supposed to protect. Lots of projects, yet the most important we neglect. We collect, infect, but do not correct. Human activities rapidly pressurizing the climate to a global warming, despite the writings on the wall. Still, we keep destroying, even with the wake-up call. This is another wake-up call to mothers and fathers, sons and daughters, industrialists and climate shakers, pulling down trees and burning gases as they please, contaminating the ocean with plastic and crude, making lands barren, leaving less food. See, the air is messed up, temperature in a rage. Noise and pollution keep making headline page. Dark clouds from factories and not forgetting cars. We live in luxury, but life is growing scarce. I say we live in luxury, but life is growing scarce. Life is good, but sometimes we lose our goodness in search of life. We are lost, or maybe trying to be lost. What if we all get lost? Like starting all over again, going back to the beginning of time. Time after time, we keep mining our future away, thinking there's a lot to gain. But what's to gain if we keep sending fumes to the air, causing climate change? Why can't we change our ways? Time is ticking. We keep digging our graves. Human activities rapidly pressurizing the climate. It's time to wake up and see Earth's pain. It's time. It's time. It's time. I believe the future holds a lot for all of us, and not just us alone, the occupants of the world too. We all have a part to play to heal this world and make it a safe place. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ibuso Naivet. Yes. Now it gets hotter. That's the libation from our children. And as I've told you, they came all the way from Ajegunle, from Bariga. I don't even know where that port is based, but I know that poets in Nigeria, this everywhere. But so they came from all over because, as I said, Lagos and Nigeria are becoming the center of poetry, especially performance poetry. We told them to rein in their energy this evening, otherwise we'll have seen them on stage. But then the mid-career poets, as Davi put them, the one we call the very young, the parents, are going to start coming out now. And I'd like to start with, many of us have heard of Lagos International Jazz Festival. That's the culmination of what I've just said, that Lagos became center for poetry all of a sudden. And we've had, we have festival almost every time. But the one who founded Lagos International Jazz, International Poetry Festival, who have been bringing in a lot of people to from all over to Nigeria, Ife, Paul Azino.
Good evening. It's such a pleasure to be here. I think poetry is central to our culture. Poetry is central to our lives. There are few things as powerful and as transformative as poetry. It calls us to listen differently. It calls us to look again, to look within, to look around. Poetry calls us to responsibility. And like the Scottish poet John Burnside cleverly puts it, when the purveyors of bottom line thinking tell us that mountains and lakes are natural resources to be exploited and used up, poetry reminds us that lakes and mountains are more than items on a spreadsheet. They are things we're responsible for. And when we stop listening to our poets, there are consequences. In March 2012, ravaging floods across North Central Nigeria killed about 430 people, and by October of the same year, had displaced millions. 8 years later, September 2020, in Nasarawa State, North Central Nigeria again, Nasarawa and Benue State, floods again killed about a dozen people, destroying hundreds of houses, livelihoods, and farmlands. There are consequences when we refuse to listen to our poets. And my first reading for this evening is called After the Floods, a poem dedicated to all the victims of the floods in 2012 and the victims who have died since then from our refusal to listen. Coepting streams and rousing lakes, the waters marched on Benue. They showed that houses and muffled screams, disaster in their wake. They licked up the dead from the belly of the earth, picked up the living and buried them in the dearth. Was it vengeance or a vendetta, or were they simply bored? Unsatisfied, they hurried on, baying still for blood. $90 million deep, the deal seemed good in Nasarawa, so they sowed rice, expecting to reap, but the waters came and nothing was left. Nature renegaded, living a harvest of death. Who will beat the chest of their keypads for the people in Adamawa? For the mother beseeching the gods as she tries to in vain to extricate her son from the clutches of the proud floods? Who will blog or dirge for the wife in Kwara? He left on a motorbike, a promise in his eyes, but the waters displaced the wheels and then transported him beyond her reach. Co-opting streams and rousing lakes, the waters marched across the land. Belching corpses, they withdrew, disaster in their wake. Never again, we swore in tears, will the waters catch us unawares? So we built a bulwark against the floods, but built it only with our words. Thank you. The many young poets in the house tonight who you've heard reading, and many more young people across Nigeria who show us and who demonstrate that beyond the failures of government, who, in spite of how difficult an environment Nigeria is, have been able to thrive in music, have been able to thrive in movies, and are thriving as well in literature and in poetry. This evening, I dedicate this poem to all of you and to everyone who's gathered here this evening and tonight in celebration of World Poetry Day. And this is for the storytellers, watchers at the temple of language, those whose heads brush against the sun, whose hearts weave tales from our laughter and spin our sorrows into songs. This is for the dreamers who first spoke today's cliches, hunched over blank papers, staring into the empty pages of computer screens like crystal balls, waiting for the spirits to whisper, those who have mostly found truth in sadness, brooding windows to the soul of the human condition. This is for those navigating silences, who refuse peace and quiet in the face of injustice, who chose gulags when the only option of freedom were in cities under jackboots, those who smuggled out their truths on toilet paper and wrote back from exile, telling us there was a country, its dream aborted under half of a yellow sun. Where would we be without the poets who showed us the path of thunder and unraveled the house of hunger? But weep not, child, the beautiful ones are not yet born. This is for the post-colonial pens, writing rainbows across a dark sky and eclipsing single stories. Those who pitch their voices against the noise, frame a new age with language, paint a better world for themselves and for us, giving nothing but alphabets. Pay no mind to the rumors, the stories are still alive. in books, in bits and bytes, in the conscience of a world dancing to the rhythm of its own delusions. This right here is for the tribe, for those who come out of their heads to drink at festivals, who still write to convince parents they can be something better than lawyers, who still write because the urge is stronger than death. This is for the last ones left, recipients of the torch, pouring sentences to keep the flame burning. Those who do this for something more than prizes, who write past rejection letters. As long as the universe holds, there will be stories to tell. And this is for the tellers, for the chosen and the few, for the tested and the true, for the howlers at the moon, for those gathered here tonight in this room. My tribe, this one is for you. Thank you.
I'd like to say, please, well, except if you have that contraption where you can lift it up, take a sip, and then put it back. But I do not see anybody who has that contraption. But please, always keep safe. I'd also like to announce that we are streaming live on YouTube and on our Instagram page, Providus Bank IG. So if you have a friend who wants to watch, who's interested in attending, please ask them to join us on social media. And it is also important that I make this recognition because I know that at some point appraisal will come and I want to be properly and well appraised. Ladies and gentlemen, I have in the house the Deputy Managing Director for Providus Bank, a man who I learned to say his name the minute I knew I was going to be doing this job at some point, Mr. Kingsley, wait for it, Aibo Kaibo. I also have in the house the Chief Financial Officer for Providus Bank, who also doubles as the head of strategy and triples as the head of business development, Dioye Ojuroye. He's also here with his lovely wife, Dasola Ojuroye. That's the intermission. The poetry can continue now. Thank you, German.
Thank you very much. Or you pay for that advert, but don't worry. And now, Evelyn Osage, a journalist, poet, and culture advocate. I think I can add that to her name. Evelyn Osage. Yes.
Heart of the forest, in the depth of the sea, beyond that savannah, on top of that hill, come the echoes of degradation. Behind rain clouds, above earth's curtains, inside hidden caves, beneath our planet cross, emission and waste choke nature, forcing her to wildfires for fossil fuels are hit with plastic bottles, non-recycled trash, plus toxic waste. Man and earth may soon be extinct. From the angry eyes of the sun to the receding steps of rivers, the forceful cool of deserts, the irate rust of tides, nature fights back for her being. Arctic and Antarctic, the crushing arms of Katrina, from Bangkok's eroding shorelines to the drying banks of River Niger, we suffer for our inactions. The melting ice and the Mexican freak summer hailstorms. The angry spill of Tennessee's torrential rain. The mad flooding in Jakarta, unsafe air in Sao Paulo, New Delhi and Beijing. These bitter pills should force our hands to end all ills against our world before it's out of hands. Against our world before it's out of hands. Thank you. I'm going to be doing something, another poem, a short poem, in honor of our own Odia Ofeimu, who turns 71 this week that passed, entitled Follow Me to Abeyigi. I like to interact with my audience. If you hear me say follow me, just say to Abeyigi, follow me to Abeyigi, follow me to Abeyigi. Before they take my mic, before I lose my mic, follow me to Abeyigi, where creative minds meet, mix, and procreate deep lines of existence. Follow me to Abeyigi, where our own Nobel laureate, Professor Wole Soyinka and Providence Bank, have gathered bright minds to wrestle the rougher that pollutes our air, the pillagers of our commonwealth. Follow me to Abeyigi. Before they take my voice, let's celebrate our distinguished Odia Ofeimu, that same Odia that asks questions with stones. Let's say to him, among death dancing thespians thumping the earth, your foot is light, your music bright, your poetry invites obeisance that will forever remain.
Odia, oh great Odia, at 71, we salute you. Follow me to Abegi. Thank you.
Evelyn Osagie, she's actually an arts writer, a journalist with the Nation newspaper. And now, we all know the story of Mamandvasa and those poets who were in uniform. And some of us were surprised that military men can write poetry because AK-47 does not speak poetry. Or it does ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. The next poet is a commander in the air wing of the Nigerian Navy, the one we call the poet of the dust, Umar Abubakar Sidi.
Poets and salamanders. Earth is a language in crisis. The alphabet is vanishing. Letter mod replaced by letter of the rising ash. Letter green replaced by letter of heat. We are losing the poetry of salamanders. Salamanders losing their sight to the rising ash in the earth's nostrils. Body scales of salamanders melting before the boiling tempers of heat. Climate. Another alphabet slowly vanishing from the book of memory. Poets are the gatekeepers of the book of memory. Earth is a language in crisis. Poets must rewrite the language of earth. Let poets gather under the Samarkand tree. Let poets invoke the electricity of letters. Let poets walk to the poles and reverse the melting of ice caps. Let poets rewrite the alphabet of sky to cement the ozone, make layers of poetry and gas to shield the soul of man and salamanders from the angry letter of heat. Let poets plant seeds of the tree of Samarkand in the book of memory. Let poets wait and watch the earth go green. Let poets become green, their poems, petals, leaves, chlorophyll. Earth is a language in crisis. Let poets save earth. And my second poem is titled Testament of Sand. Testament of Sand, Genesis or Book of God. Al-Arshad, poet of sand. Al-Arshad, poet of dust. Al-Arshad, poet of the testament. Al-Arshad, poet of mud. Al-Arshad, poet of sand, poet of the ocean of sand, where the particles of sand are consumed like fine grains of milk. Al-Arshad, poet of dust, poet of the waterfalls of dust, poet of the expanding worlds which are swelling over infinite space as floating corks of dust. Al-Arshad, poet of the testaments, the tall tambourine of the family of drums, the accursed poet, the black sheep, a tarantula who testified against the tentacles of time. Al-Arshad, poet of mud, they said, you were there when God molded mud to make man in the image of man. They said, you were there when God breathed into man the immortal breath of God. They said, it was you who scribbled the destiny of man on the bare soul of life. They said it was you who implanted the fall and the scroll of life as metaphor for a twist of fate. They said you are Eve, or the aromatic curves of Eve. Some say you are the vituperative fangs of the serpent. Some say no, you are the bushy value of life, the forbidden fruit tucked between the mighty thighs of Eve. They said it was you who created mythos to distract man from deciphering the original face of God hidden behind palisades of clouds. They said it was you who carved out logos from the left ear of God. They said it was you who created the alphabet and encrypted it with metaphors. And when God said, "Let there be light," you were there as the form of the photon, the tiniest quark of dust. And when God peeped into the void, you were there as the shadow of darkness, omnipresent in the nothingness of things. And when God said, "Let the universe be," you were there as the big that banged, the bang that bigged. And when God said, "Let us shape the destiny of man," you were there as the pen and the scroll, the scribbles and the scribe. Al-Arshad, poet of many colors, the purple mare of paradise, the chlorophyll in the garden of red, the red Arakarabura, the yellow hissing flames of hell. Al-Arshad, the many season of songs. To the angels, you are the serpent, the venomous viper filled with bile. To Eve, you are the blessed rod, the pathway to endless bliss, the monstrous, delicious member of man. To man, you are vinegar, the white water, crystal drops, the sacred elixir of lust. To words, you are the emptiness between the letters, the very gap separating E and O, V and L. To words, you are the neutrinos, the photons, protons of language, the central atom of speech. To God, you are the force, always the force, the pestle that stirred the cosmic soup when God said, "Let's make life." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Umar Abubakar Sidi, the commander in the Navy wing, in the air wing of the Navy, of Nigerian Navy. And next is an actor, a multi-skilled actor, poet, cultural advocate, someone who has practiced his acting career outside of this place, and one who has published 8 books of poetry collection and writing plays too. Reginald Ofodile.
Good evening all. My first item is deserved appreciation. Fine old Brazilian streets of Lagos in decay, eroded walls and windows cracked and filth display, where Henry Carr and H. Macaulay strode like kings, are rubble heaps and stench and flies with deadly stings. Astounding sums are sometimes spent to smash and raise, constructing hideous piles of concrete, chrome, and glaze. In my hometown is a historic church destroyed. The so-called modern bigger one can't fill its void. Do we not know our aged piles should make us proud, part of the heritage with which we've been endowed? Our world abounds with Philistines whose bent I rue. They've no respect for relics, craving just the new. The Britons' rituals and reserve might some detest. With British care for the antique, I'm most impressed. Oh, that with master courage, grace, and style today, to save our heritage from wreckage and decay. My next item is the prettiest warrior. Source of thrills, both visual and aromatic. Exquisite, so superbly wrought. You prove nature's superlative artist whose genius no John Constable or Van Gogh, those famous painters of blossoms, could hope to touch. For you, dear orchid, are exquisite beyond words. Your petals, whose tints are riveting, might to the touch be finest silk or rarest velvet. The scents you diffuse defy description, but ceaselessly enthrall. You, so fine and fragile, are yet a warrior, like fearsome armies, armored ships and planes, combating the blights that assail our world, that assail nature's cycles and balance. As you dispense the unseen boon, oxygen, without which human existence would not endure beyond minutes, you fight, you thrust swords and bullets at forces both natural and man-made, which seek to annihilate our world. Dear orchid, though pretty, fragile, fragrant, and rarefied beyond words, you are a warrior. Unflinching, ferocious, absorbing bombs, fighting to preserve lives and protect the planet Earth.
Thank you very much, Reginald Ofodile. And now to wrap up this segment of the parents of mid-career poets, Akim Lasisi, also a journalist, who is also a writer.
Because there may never be a second night, I shall plant my tongue in the soil of tonight. I shall construct a castle of words as an eternal monument for a lettered sage. Emon Rat rises earthily in Opoile. Afiribojo rises earthily in its hole. Whether Ekwemon rises well or not, once Soyinka rises well, the deed is done. On that note, I say good evening. The title of my first, my poem is The Divination. Months after departing from the East, the sun has yet to birth in the lingering West. Blinded by vagabond smokes and a hail of turbulence from flaring gas. Weather forecasters are stammering in a fit. Farmers have lost the track of seeding seasons as fog grows from the boards of solar panels. There is an infernal disconnect in geography class. And so the earth flounders, totters to the knowledgeable one. Akere finu sogmo eleri ipin se porun mi la ni ko ni loran gege bi ye kan ni o orun mi la ni fun ni loro bi ye kan ni. Behave says the yam in whom we trust. No more yields nothing other than kernel palms. Farmers have lost the track of seeding seasons, and fog grows from the board of solar panels. O ye knowledgeable one, convey our woes to the azure one. And upon the divination tree, the sky appears but in a mangled body. Her eyes as red as charcoal fire, her ethereal gown now a million bottles of flagrant oils, and the earth falls at the feet of the divination god, unable to withstand the face of the mangled sky. And so says the knowledgeable one, that months after departing from the east, the sun has yet a birth in the lingering west. Blinded by vagrant smokes and a hail of turbulence from vagabond hills. Oro global warming ta kukun wi e ma bi inu mo tun ti dodo jala mi omo jala ruru ire ni mogun kuku ni mi omo la isi eji wan de ara la gbede omo awori mo tun ro re mogun omo ayo ti nje eji gbojo ayo yen ke ni mi se boyun ye ya mi loju obi mi fun baba oro global warming ta nwi oro climate change ta nwi mo ni everybody le lokan gbogbo wa ke je ka mo sora se won ni eye sona sinu gbomo won ni eye dijumo ri ke mo gegi nigbo e mo dale soju ona mo e mo sunle lojo ona mo won ni ke ye kole yin sibi ti odo gbe nsan mo fi ni ogun ma ma je o se mi o ogun ma ma je o se mi kogun ma ma je o se mi o ogun ma ma je o se mi a global warming to sagbado ti o gbo ma pon ogun ma ma je o se mi climate change to sagbado ti o gbo ma pon kogun ma ma je o se mi. Thank you very much.
I'm going to attempt that. I have come again, yo, with my announcement. Come on, a round of applause, please, for me. Thank you. Akim Lasisi there. You know, when I hold a microphone, I'm here to do some announcements, and I love this job because I am announcing prestigious people. In our midst, from the South African Consulate General, we have the Consul General, Daki Ephraim Africa. A round of applause for him, please. Thank you very much, sir, for honoring our invitation. And I also have here the head of Chancery, Office of the High Commission of India, in the pressing of Mr. Rachit Rawat. Namaste, sir. Thanks for attending our event. Jaman, we would have a short intermission for 5 minutes, and it's my pleasure again to introduce the voice, Yinka Davis.
So I
time that we share together, babe. I cannot understand how we ever let things get so bad. Shouldn't have let you go. Let you out of my sight, baby. Never knew how much I care. Never knew.
Davis, please give a round of applause for Yinka Davis. We're glad to have her. And back by Femi Okunua, Ayo, and Uche. I didn't get the name of Yinka. Okay.
is acknowledged. There are very few people who start to bear the sobriquet Baba, even when they were younger. Before Odia was 50, we already called him Baba because of the role he played in our lives. As I said, there were two of them who came after the Soyinka, J.P. Clark, Achebe generation, and they started taking some of us by the hand, and they made us the poets or the poemist like me, or the actor that some of us have become. Odia Femon was a Baba even before he became an old man. And last year, it was his birthday that actually brought the corona. Because the moment we stepped out of the hall, on the 17th, they locked down Lagos on the 19th. Please tell me, it's only Odia that could have created that kind of ruckus. But Odia Femon was 17 last year, and there was a big conference at the University of Lagos for him. He was to be the special guest of honor for the poet, chosen by the MD himself, who approved it. So this evening, we're glad to honor Odia Femon, and I'll bring him here to do what he knows how to do best. And he has assured me he's not going to throw stone this evening, but he will throw stones of words. Odia Femon, please.
This is from my latest collection, Geography as Fate. And this particular one, Rivers of the Delta. When I think of my country, every journey hacks afresh through timber and rock hill in arguments elementary, brashly toasting the Niger Benue, stomping heartily into confluence from polar distances. Sea words stubborn to display of River Non and Forcados, sibling rivers shimming along the occult sorties of Boni and Brass, Cross River, Escravos, Ethiopia, Oste and Siloco, rivers of the Delta, silting every leverage in spit and spat, blood and oil sorting all the spoils in grand fealty. With the wetlands kindling shared living as fate, grating and coalescing in warfare trade, grit and grapple. Oh, when I think of my country, I rule the hunting packs, East India and Royal Niger Company, sizing up the art as reason to mock the natives, kingdom after humbled kingdom. This is my original Lagos poem. It's titled Lagoon. I let the lagoon speak for my memory. Though offended by water hyacinth waste and nice soil, I still let the lagoon reclaim the seduction of the land moving with the desire of a sailing ship pursuing a known star. The lagoon speaks like a fetus remembering the future, listening from the depths of formless song for the words that break against the voyages of discovery in the discovery of voyages. My lagoon speaks. Gateway and storehouse never dry, in regatta floats hauling epic seasons, in floors that take over the lordly garbage of our alleys after the rains have registered their pity. I let the lagoon speak for my memory to teach me how to scoff at the lines drawn on water to divide the earth. I let the lagoon teach me to forget street names in order to gulp whole cities like a glass of color wine. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Odia Ofemon. I think he deserves a bigger one. Thank you for that. Times are changing. In another time, Odia will have spent 10 minutes, as I told him. We decided to do a short one. I think you got a memo from Prof. I wasn't there. But now we just take a quick short break, music, so that we can move to the grand finale. Thank you very much, the trio of Ayo, Femi, Uche. That music was just to set us in the mood for what is to come next, which is actually the grand finale.
And I hope everybody got a copy of 2009, A Space Odyssey, because that is what is coming. It's some heavy stuff. And I hope that we will all be set for this. A Space Odyssey featuring Wole Soyinka, Taiwo Ajayi Laiset, and Bimbo Manuel.
Ladies and gentlemen, we want to take you for a ride. Please. Part of the problem that we have among especially young people is that they take poetry too seriously. They think poetry is nothing but a solemn, gloomy, somber preoccupation. Actually, poetry is supposed to have a sense of humor. And we're going to read you what is a kind of a semi-autobiographical tract and experience. These my two fellow astronauts in training. As you see, their costume is different from mine. Move a bit to paraphrase now. Give me some space. Come on. Respect your boss. Right. So we're going to read this mock heroic. It's written in the mock heroic fashion, just to lighten the proceedings of poetry a little bit. One or two names will crop up here. Not many of you are like me. Not many of you are scientists. So when we hear the name of Stephen Hawking, we know exactly what you're talking about, the genius, the scientific genius. He'll crop up somewhere here because he also has been in space. But he went after I did. So I called him my junior brother. Now, some of you might wonder, what has space travel to do with the Earth? Poems in praise of Earth, in cause of Earth. Well, space is where all of us are going if you mess up the Earth. It's one of the reasons I've interested myself and booked a seat on a space rocket so that when you're finished destroying the Earth, at least I'll have somewhere to go. I'll be looking at all of you from outer space. So, are you ready? Lead off.
Prelude.
It was written, a space nut, astronaut monkey, who never orbited beyond the round trip, Dakar to Singapore, Tokyo to Madrid, would have his day. Till then, human or robot, Yuri Gagarin, Armstrong, Sojourner, Spirit, Zuke, Apollo, Soyuz orbiter, spacewalk.
Even Michael Jackson's moonwalk.
Curiosity, the roll call stood surrogates for his great entry into space.
Each launch that failed launched in turn a listless day, a private burden of failure. Each tragedy claimed a week, a month of silent grief and fervid fears that earthbound voices, Scrooges of public births would soar thereafter, higher than man's desire to soar. He heard them, eye on cash returns, gloating pennywise, toasting in their hearts each scorched descent of brave conveyances, heirs of Icarus.
Haunting the mind at will, a ghost tale told in the witching hours of night, was the Russian trio's final eerie sleep. Descent was book perfect, radio signals, carousing songs of sky gods to earthlings, earthed.
To anxious.
Earthed on, can I have a better light, please? Oh, this thing is what's causing the shadow. Oh, okay. I'll take that again. Yes, that's a bit better. A I'll go back. Haunting the earth at will, a ghost tale told in the witching hours of night was Russian trio's final eerie sleep. Descent was book perfect, radio signals, carousing songs of sky gods to anxious ears earthed at command center. Through multi-density layers of space, the capsule lanced its fiery swathe, parachutes deployed as groomed.
Such grace, it lacked only Stravinsky's Firebird to herald yet another triumph of utopia skills.
It proved a death pod bearing duty's price. Space had claimed a threesome sacrifice. A leakage left their hearts in void, sent their bodies home.
All too soon, the turn of broken seals, tiles distempered, a chariot of flames over America. Men had stumbled, the sky gods dispensed a rain of shredded pride and dare. The nation mourned. A chastened world retreated. He poured maledictions of O-rings, their fatal flaw, cursed television's anchorman's clinical dissection.
Flat, indifferent tone, unflappably professional, reiterating moments of disaster without pause or pain. That was rock salt, chafing Roner's still at infinity. Yet, could he bear to tear away his gaze, plug his ears from reruns, slow motion, fast forward, magnifying pinpricks of material laws that tore adrift his proud protagonist?
No. Voyeur, he lived it through and vowed, let steel and flesh confetti mark Earth's wedding match with brides of space. No planet bears the name defeat. Galaxies must yield to Earth's restless argosies. When George Bush Senior glided free fall, an ageless birdman, jubilant at 80 years, he forgave father and son their earthly sins.
Countdown, zero gravity.
Yes, it was written. The timing seemed the gift of empathizing deities. A free ticket to zero G. Experience weightlessness, float as space was light years loftier than Ali's afloat like a butterfly. Partake of the astronaut's
sensation.
Partake of the astronaut sensation read to his ears, sip space ambrosia with cosmic beings. Zero G. They found him pride at weighing set. What greater gift at 75 before decrepitude damned such venturous folly? Anxious not to be found, wanting, diagnosed physically unfit, an insurance risk, he prescribed himself 2 weeks to G-Day, fewer sedentary hours, bouncy walks. Religiously, he took his daily diazide. Blood vessels running wild, erratic heart, routing on the appointed day. Not he. Not for one who had waited long to share orbit colors with his adopted clan. G-Day found him in good shape. For your age, the flippant doctor grinned and eager.
He signed the liability waivers, indemnity forms, personal injury, specific risks include, but not limited to, exemptions from Part 91, Part 25 of Fed Air Regulations, parabolic flight offered under Part 121, risks include injury from sudden change in gravity, your body's physical contact with aircraft interior, other bodies, decompression, loss of consciousness, explosive decompression. Affirm that zero G kept nothing concealed, releases binding on my heirs, executors, assigns, and allied gobbledygook. Come on, let's go.
Yes, sir. San Jose, July 11, rendezvous. The lined up blue overall. Spacecraft, a cavernous Boeing 707 disemboweled, customized, railings only for handholds, refitted, padded, most appropriately, as befits space loonies, young and old. Preparations have been thorough. What food to take or avoid for breakfasters? He spurned even his soul espresso fix. Briefing was music, housekeeping notes, heroic verse. Adrenaline to be discharged as excess baggage once the voyage was done. Eagerness suppressed, facial composure feigned. He looked the coolest astro of them all.
Had he but known, one prodigious mind also nursed the pangs of space, whose healing came months after, even in cruel constraint. A body imprisoned, brain unleashed to roam through matter, time and light, probing atoms, battling the great enigma of origin to unravel the calculus of life, he would have won a vest emblazoned. Too late, Steve Hawkins, genius. Greetings from Ijebaland. We hit space before you. Signed, Ogun Kanako.
Flight routine prescribed renaming rights for all. In undergur to stamp them superbreed, daring the unknown. His choice was instant. Ogun Kanako, patron god of voyagers, he who folds distances so wafer thin all dimension sees, measure is annulled, Egbe that rules land and ocean roots, pleats time from anvils lodged in rocket thrusts, hurls engine through dark holes, lord of the magnetic needle, lodestone in constellations of the celestial forge, Ibar.
The drill was easy. Pairing, group formations. The law of space is lack of force. A gentle push captures distances in zero gravity till deactivated by a counter move. Do not try to swim or kick. There's no distance as in water. Here is only nothing. Drift.
Cosmos unbound.
They boarded, strapped to jump seats, endured a final check. Impressive in flight suits, glorified overalls, compassionate foot gear to pad reflexive kicks from flailing feet. The plane taxied to liftoff. So far, it could be any scheduled flight from Dallas to St. Louis.
Trajectory was closed. They climbed the calibrated 1,000 feet to pierce the stratosphere. It all seemed logical, precise. The order came, they scrambled to stretch flat, then rose as drilled, a predetermined height was prelude to a sudden earthward dive, the first parabola. It took them to red planet, Martian gravity. Press up routine, consummate. The body rose on fingertips. They savored mild weight loss greedily as big losers on reality show. All too soon, it was time again to
hit the floor.
Now the turn of the romantic orb, lunar gravity, man's first port of call in space. Its conquest, What an eternity, it seemed, now dulled with time, had found him doubly earthed, stoutly barred, yet spaced out, weightless in prison solitude. But from his padlocked cell, he saw it all, the Michelin figure bounding cracked veil of dust. Transmission came to him unfiltered, where the mind defies all censorship. At night he lay, lone witness of Neil Armstrong's primal feet, where man and moon united. The skeptic in his jailer had alerted him, overcame his ordered clamminess. Came lock-up time, he lingered, eyeing the sky with scorn. Such liars, these white folk. They say they'll land him man up there on that moon tonight. First, it's sacrilege. Then, impossible. Up there, he thrust the new scrap through the grill and turned away. Read it yourself, Abba. Why tell such lies? And spat a ruffled cola gob.
Up there? Yes, but no. Not down. Just there. Where earthly senses lose all compass points. That night, he levitated at the appointed hour, prison bars dissolved. He rose. He paired with Armstrong in a dance for Tante and chained.
But now, that moon, invisible, takes you by the hand, tilts you to your feet. The weightless bounds are modest. Your mind re-echoes one small step for man, a giant step for humanity. Few fellow kangaroos bound past on mimic lunarscape. He felt the pool of earth diminish. Eat your heart out, Norman Mailer. No bravura faction this. Just one hop, step, and jump. Or a Michael Jackson double fake in choreographed illusion. Still, end it must. Too soon for second takes, they obeyed the taut command.
Hit the floor.
Hit the floor. Rapidly prone, they dived. Less floor turned literal and mid-routine, gravity proved master of their bodies in landless air.
Again. The craft rose. They felt a poise or apogee, a routine. He'd watched the hunter kite pursue, stretched on windstream, wings and eyelid flutter, spotter eyes ruthless, feathered rocket tensed, alert to a moving quarry. But now, time to fall prone. Steel propulsion pointed earthwards for the terminus, the ultimate quest of dreams, that prized prey, the promised out-of-body thrill. Gently, their bodies levitated, variations in blue. Stanley Kubrick's futuristic resurrection, the terminus of the voyage of a million light years, time contracted, whence brutally the spell was shattered.
Whoopee!
Nirvana. Space should be, for so he willed it, a vast sidereal silence, not yodeling and whoops of cowboy rodeo astronauts killed with glee. His soundless hymn of space desecrated, the craved divorce of flesh and gravity. He fumed. Was a pact of silence mandatory? A code of instinct taught? A space omerta sworn? Space should be noiseless, a cosmic library of secret hives of mind opened into infinity. Spell crumbled in a thousand falling stars, turned ash and cinders. He sighed, swallowed the imprecations, turned to maximize leftovers. Graceless, his flotation to the next routine.
Grace lay in wait, patient, poised, a vision in serenity. But first, formations from pre-boarding tutelage. Crawling Spider-Man suctioned to ceiling. Then Superman, a slight kick against the fuselage, equatorial arms outstretched, flat against conjectured landscapes, non-directional. A companion's kick ended its trajectory. Embarked on a wall crawl variation, another spun him into a rival's orbit. They settled for a brief impromptu no contact waltz. Apotheosis was close.
It came like breath. Demure, a tutor plant, froze all motions, muted even the involuntary gasps. A mystic shawl enveloped all. Her lithe frame folded in a lotus pose in ascension, drifted upward to nirvana. She seemed all ectoplasm, hardly human, a marvel all too brief. The ragged group required no urging, formed a circle. All was awed silence. They took turns to pass her gently. A mere touch, and she flowed to her next adoration. Even the touch seemed sacrilegious. She was a bodhisattva from suspended life. Now that came close, close to the lair of the elusive dwelling place of the unbounded space.
Recessional.
All sense the infinite. All partake or dream of its communion, dissolution of senses, and through both incongruities and affinities, mystics, somnambulists shed substance, levitate over parked cars and trees, over waterfalls. No, not as evil Knevel on his demon motorbike in deadly stunts, nor zombies wreathed in psychedelic haze. They drift through bedroom windows, walls, through ceilings, down staircases, clutching banisters to earth their disembodiment. Around them, silence reigns impenetrable. Drift over the edge of the world, silence so huge and sleep, it conjures fears of the unthinkable, death by drowning in dry air. Awake, though steeped in sleep or meditation, immobilized yet taut as wind-filled sails, dread yet loath to break the spell, to dissipate the mystic manifold of self-dissolve.
The voyage dims from Earth to zero G, all done too brief, but the image lingers. A bodhisattva's peace on lotus air, a vision raised beyond the din of ageless youths. All compass gone, neither north nor south, up or down, west or east, the ethereal without ether.
A finger's tap sent her from hand to hand, the plane's parabola yielding just a 30-second emanation, each nanosecond stretched beyond the infinite. Earth, thought, memory abolished. Like an enigmatic koan of Zen, he breathed it. Unscented incense, Satori, space at last.
Space haunts, taunts, sermonizes to the world. It is that questing for the infinite, a sum of inner plenitude beyond life or death. Disavowal of tethers, the cosmic sacramental act, prefigured end of world cacophony, banal divisions. A low celestial body floats in tune to a finger's pulse, in silence, space.
Postscript, 2019, breaking news. From cosmic realms, the Martian rover Opportunity is silenced. 15 years of service to Earthlings, transmitting images, decoding wind and tremors, foraging, surveying magnetic fields, grading soil, hunting precious stones, gross metal, dodging rocks and pits, tracking riverbeds of timeless vintage, sniffing microbial telltales for signs of once upon a life. It rested nights like humans, re-energized from the sun, the valiant robot finally succumbed in the veil named Perseverance.
Post-mortem.
Palos in clogged sun panels after planetary storms. Demise, February 13, 2019, terrestrial calendar. Last message. My battery is low and it's getting dark. Hardened NASA scientists reduced to tears responded. Could it have been otherwise with Ogukanaku's favorite singer and song, Billie Holiday's I'll Be Seeing You. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you.
It's Space Odyssey.
Spaceship Ijeba, my fellow astronaut.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, our space. And I'll make a request of Professor Wole Soyinka. You'll be taking pictures with the poets. Please, all the poets who have performed tonight, please come on stage. All the poets, please. All the poets who have performed on stage.
The children's carousel.
Quiet, come on stage, please. All the poets are performed. Please come on stage.
The wishing well.
All the poets who have performed and the mentors of the poets, please. Check my defila. All the poets who have performed and those who came with the group.
The managing director
of Providence Bank and his wife to join us here.
Think of you that way.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'll find you in the morning.
It's just for photo ops.
Sun. And when the night is. I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you.
May I request the ambassador, Erelu, Chief Jibuna, and Chief Kaudi Adeniyoko, please. We'll shortly be joined by Professor Wole Soyinka, Taiwa Jaila said, and Bimbo Manu. We will now be joined by Professor Wole Soyinka, Taiwa Jaila said, and Bimbo Manuel. Okay, let's take this picture. We're being joined by Professor Strange, the DMD, please. The DMD, please. And the CFO. The DMD and the CFO. And their wives, if you are here. Bentomologu, please. Bentomologu. Just photo up. Thank you very much, everybody who have been here. That was the grand finale. And we have just finished, and then now it's your job entertainment. But make sure you get a copy of this book. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you very much. I don't think there's anything more to say other than say thank you. We appreciate you for attending this event. Thank you very much.
just in case the book or the poem that was read by Professor Wole Soyinka, Mrs. Taiwo Ajayi, and Mr. Bimbo Manuel is titled 2009 Space Odyssey for children under the age of 90 and above. Please hold your copy on your way out. It's a momentous occasion. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Chairman Anikulapo. Thank you.
Thank you.